Hachette Audio presents Lion and Lamb, written by James Patterson and Duane Swierczynski, read by Corey Carthew, Lisa Flanagan, and Joshua Kane.
For Parker and Evie, D.S.
Prologue, Sunday, January 23rd. 1. 12:20 a.m.
The night Philadelphia lost its mind, police officer Deborah Parks was patrolling the ninth with her rookie, Rob Sheplavi. He was a nice enough kid, maybe a little overeager. They'd been together since just after New Year's Day, when the red and gold holiday decorations were quickly replaced by Eagles green banners to celebrate the team clawing its way to the NFC playoffs. Now, it was just after midnight on a freezing Sunday in late January, when Philly was at its darkest and coldest. The Birds were facing off against the Giants, and aside from a few rowdy drunks with their faces painted green, the residents of the city had apparently decided to take a collective breather before tonight's kickoff. As they went around the Museum of Art toward Eakin's Oval, Sheplavi's face lit up.
Ooh, check out that sweet Maserati!
Parks followed his sightline to the sports car, which had been detailed with a laser-blue holographic wrap. The thing literally glowed in the street, where it appeared to have paused at a stoplight at the far end of the traffic circle. Only problem, the traffic circle had no light. But still, the Maserati had come to a dead stop, nose slightly out of its lane.
What's up with this guy? Parks said.
Look, we're going to pull up a little closer and I'll check it out. You stay here.
Wait, can I come with you?
I need you to hang back, and don't touch the radio.
Parks hated being rough with the new kid, but he had a tendency to go rogue, and she knew something was off about this even before she climbed out of the car. As Parks moved closer, she could see someone slumped behind the wheel of the glowing vehicle. Was the driver passed out drunk? No, the body language was all wrong. His head was tilted at an unnatural angle. His shoulders were completely still, and there was no sign of breathing. Parks glanced back to make sure the rookie was where he should be.
Stay in the car, Sheplavi!
If the rookie heard, he didn't respond. Steeling herself, Parks moved to the driver's side, hand near her service weapon just in case the guy turned out to be A, alive, and B, drunk and pissed. But she knew that would be the best-case scenario. Parks called out to him, trying to wake him up. The driver didn't stir. She reached in and touched the side of his neck with two fingers. The man's skin was ice cold, and there was no pulse. Parks had forgotten to put on gloves, and when she lifted her fingers away from the driver's neck, she was surprised to find them tacky. She looked down at her hands and realized that the city's new LED streetlights had made the body look as if it were covered in shadows. But it was blood. So much blood.
2. Audio transcript of police officer Deborah Parks' body cam footage.
What are you doing with that radio in your hand?
I called in the plate number. Figured I'd save us some time.
Damn it, Shep. What did I tell you about shutting up and staying off the radio?
Why are you freaking out? We're supposed to call this in, right?
I told you to wait, and that's all you needed to know. Now get out of the car and get the crime scene tape out of the trunk.
What happened over there? Is that guy all right?
No, he's pretty much the opposite of all right, which is why I need you to go in the trunk and dig out some flares and crime scene tape.
Jesus.
You got a problem, rookie?
Whatever's in that car, I can handle it. I'm not a toddler.
Look, I'm sorry for snapping, but you just put out the license plate of a potential murder victim's car over the radio. You know who listens to the police band? TV reporters. Not to mention people bored or twisted enough to come check out a crime scene.
I'm sorry, I didn't...
Everybody's excited about the first dead body until they actually see it.
Oh, Christ, look, I said I'm sorry.
It's fine. Just remember rule number one, do not touch anything. You got me?
I know. I promise, Parks. I'm good.
The officers approach the Maserati. The Vic is partially obscured by the wheel and the door of the Maserati. Shaplavi crouches down for a better look.
You've got to be kidding me.
What is it?
It couldn't be. I mean, tonight of all nights.
Shaplavi, what? Hey, you okay? Take a deep breath. We need to secure the scene. I'm thinking this is a carjacking gone wrong, that's all.
I can't believe...
Look, we're going to see this kind of thing from time to time. Are you... Shaplavi, are you crying?
I can't believe it's actually... him!
Can't believe it's who?
Look at his face!
3.
As the rookie was sobbing, a tall man in a dirty gray hoodie cut across Eakin's oval. When he spied the two cops, he stopped in his tracks. He pulled his phone from his pocket and snapped a photo. Then he inched closer, a stunned expression on his face.
Hey, back off! Parks shouted. Crime scene!
Too late. The hoodie guy snapped another photo and ran away, thumbing something into his phone as he went.
Hey, stop!
A photo of the Vic was going to be online in a matter of seconds. Shit. But what was she supposed to do? Chase after him and... what? Confiscate his phone? While leaving a rookie alone at his first murder scene? It turned out that Parks had been right to worry. When the two images of the blood-covered man in the Maserati hit social media, it was over. The news traveled worldwide at breakneck speed. People enlarged the grainy photos until the victim's face was pixelated, but identifiable. The reaction everywhere? Utter astonishment. Some claimed the photos were photoshopped or deep-faked, but most who saw the images believed they were real. The powder blue Maserati alone was confirmation of the victim's identity. Online, there was collective grief and an instantaneous outpouring of tributes. There were also macabre jokes, as always. And even though it was well after midnight, locals began to gather at the scene, arriving from Center City and Spring Garden and Fairmount and West Philly. As the crowds got bigger, more images from the crime scene spread online. Some people took awkward selfies in an attempt to place themselves in this historic moment. Some simply stared in shock. Some wept inconsolably, held by their friends. Fortunately, Parks and Shaplavi had been joined by half a dozen other officers from the 9th, and they'd established a wide perimeter around the car, so between that and the wall of bodies, the victim's face was largely blocked from view. Unless you were in a helicopter. Parks had been right about local TV news always keeping an ear on police radio. An overnight staffer chained to the assignment desk at the local NBC affiliate heard the word Maserati and had a cop friend run the license plate on a whim. Maybe some local CEO or sports figure had been involved in an embarrassing traffic accident. But when the Maserati's owner's name popped up, the staffer knocked over his Diet Coke in his scramble to get to the assignment editor. That station's news chopper was kept at Penn's Landing, which was 30 minutes from any location in the city. The art museum was so close, however, that the chopper was circling overhead within 5 minutes. A minute after it arrived, the station was interrupting the local broadcast to go live with footage from the air. Until they had official word from the Philly police brass, that meant a captain or higher, the station couldn't confirm exactly who was in the powder blue Maserati. But the word was already out, and distraught fans on the street knew the truth. Philadelphia would never be the same.
4. 1:02 a.m.
Homicide Detective Mickey Bernstein, 43, was the son of a Philly PD homicide legend, Arnold Arnie Bernstein. Dad was famous for working the city's most violent cases and resolving them with lightning speed, usually thanks to his hunches and gut feelings. He nailed gangsters, the guys who blew up Leo Chicken Man Karanchi, and serial killers, co-ed slayer Herman the Guru Bloodhorn. Every administration since the early 1960s loved Arnie. He got results. Nobody questioned him. Ever. Arnie's only son operated in much the same way, except Mickey had a degree from UPenn under his belt and extensive forensic training to back up his hunches. So he got even more respect than his famous father. What was not to love?
He was a street-smart cop with an Ivy League degree who knew how to talk to TV and print journalists. Philadelphia Magazine had run a fawning profile on him a few years back, and the cover still hung in his parents' retirement home in Margate, Florida. If you were doing a true crime doc about something that happened in Philly and you didn't check in with Mickey Bernstein, you were just not doing your job.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.